It's my pleasure to be your moderator for this evening's discussion. I'm with CBC Radio. Some of you may know me from hosting the show Fresh Air, which was the weekend morning show on CBC Radio 1. I am also a board member for Roots of Empathy. This is now my second year, and it is a wonderful organization. I cannot speak highly enough. And Mary Gordon is a visionary. It's a shame that she can't be with us tonight, but if you ever get a chance to meet her, you will immediately feel it and know it, the way she talks about this organization, her commitment to it, her passion. Now, I should tell you too, I mean, this is a very intimate setting, and it is a sold-out crowd tonight, although it was free. And I think it's because the topic really hit a chord with people. It's something they're very interested in. And as well, because of our panel tonight. I mean, we have a lot of brilliant minds here and also in the audience. Empathy has been a hot topic. I don't know if you've noticed this in recent years. Former U.S. President Barack Obama made a statement about a deficit in empathy. And this has also been echoed by other leaders in politics, industry, academia, a deficit of empathy or a lack of empathy in people today. And it has been pervasive in the news recently. Just this week, we heard, and this was actually a very serious news item, the man who was shot during Friday's protests at the University of Washington expressed empathy towards the shooter. Closer to home, former Dragon's Den star Arlene Dickinson said Kevin O'Leary, who is now a contender for the federal conservative leadership, showed a total lack of empathy for Canadians on the show. And I just happened to read an article, I just picked it up, it was in the Huffington Post, about one woman's 12-month plan for greater empathy and understanding in 2017. This was her New Year's resolution. So where do the arts fit into this ongoing conversation on empathy? If it's true that we have a deficit in empathy, what role can the arts, such as film, fiction, paintings, sculpture, artifacts, play? Can we actually foster empathy through art and create a more caring, understanding, and civil society? These are questions that we'd like to explore today with our panel. And with us on our panel, to my far left, Cameron Bailey, the Artistic Director of the Toronto International Film Festival. He is responsible for the overall vision and execution of festival programming and maintaining relationships with Canadian and international film industries. Toronto Life named him one of Toronto's 50 most influential people 4 years in a row. And personally, I can say he's certainly been an influence in the literary scene. He successfully championed the book Rue by Kim Tui in 2015. Rue was the winner of CBC's Canada Reads contest, and it won the title, The One Book to Break Barriers. Martha Durdin in the center is the chair of the Board of Trustees at the Royal Ontario Museum. She is also the president and CEO of the Canadian Credit Union Association, and she was the managing principal of Navigator Limited, a leading strategic public affairs firm. Martha also served for 12 years as the chair of the Ontario Arts Council. And to my immediate left is Raymond Mar. He is an associate professor of psychology at York University. He employs the methods of personality psychology, social psychology, and neuroscience to research the real-world influence of imaginative experiences. This includes engagement with fictional narratives in various media, such as novels, films, video games. Dr. Mar is also a co-editor of onfiction.ca, an online magazine on the psychology of fiction. So you can see we've got a very diverse panel covering a lot of different areas of the arts. Let's start then with film and theater. And can you talk about, you know, some of the latest research in that area, what you know?
Sure, absolutely. I would say that with all these areas, we're sort of at early stages. You know, we are always looking forward to seeing more data on these topics, but the studies that we have are very interesting, very intriguing, and somewhat compelling. And so what people have done is they've actually randomly assigned students, they could be young children or they could be undergraduates or so forth, and asked them to take part in acting lessons. right? And then other people might be on a control condition where they're simply waiting for these acting lessons, or they could be asked to be doing other things like music lessons and so forth. And so the idea is that if it's possible that training in acting, this idea of assuming different roles, assuming different identities, assuming different characters, can help us to better understand people who might be different from us, then there should be measurable changes in their behavior towards others. And that's kind of what we see. And so there's great research out of Dr. Winter's own lab that has demonstrated this, that young children that are asked to take acting lessons over a number of weeks actually appear to be more pro-social and more empathetic towards other people. There's also a similar study that was done right here in Toronto by Glenn Schellenberg at the University of Toronto in Mississauga. And he was actually interested in studying music lessons, but as a control condition, he decided that he'd have some people take acting lessons. And as it turned out, it was those children that were in the acting lessons that teachers later on rated them as being more pro-social, more empathetic and caring towards other, and they were the only ones that showed this effect, that were in that condition.
So that is when children assume the role, right? They are acting. What about watching? What do we know about when we are watching a film, not acting?
Right. Yeah, so this is something that we've also been trying to study in various forms. Again, you know, I always feel like I have to give out this caveat of the science is still in its early stages. But certainly it does seem like when we're watching the actions of another person, we tend to, in our brains, activate similar brain regions as what we'd use to enact those same kinds of actions. So it seems like there's evidence that we are mentally simulating what's going on in the screen to some degree, right? So we seem to be taking upon these roles and these actions. Now, I wouldn't say that it's gonna be the same for everybody, right? I think that people can enjoy cinema without taking on these perspectives, without empathizing with the characters. I think that there's going to be what we'd refer to as individual differences or variability, or basically different people respond differently.
That to me, though, seems more of a neuroscience explanation.
Sure.
Right? That's not a behavioral explanation.
Right.
So how do we know that just because that certain part of your brain lights up or whatever, that translates to empathy?
Right. So we don't know. You know, I don't think that we have great evidence that shows this yet. What I think that we have is a mixture of partial pieces of the picture. So another piece of the picture is a study that I did with young children, and these are children between the ages of 4 and 6 years old. And between those ages, children become aware of the fact that other people have mental states. They have thoughts and preferences and emotions, and that these can differ from their own thoughts, preferences, and emotions. What we found was that parents that were better at recognizing the names and titles of children's films, sort of a proxy for probably the amount of exposure that these young children had to children's films, that their children actually were more advanced in this understanding about other people's mental states.
Mm-hmm. Do we know, too, when, let's say, a child is watching a film, is it necessarily the so-called good character that they're always identifying with?
We don't know that. I mean, I don't think there's been any studies on that. And I think that it's quite possible that children process film in ways different from adults. They certainly process television in ways different than adults. So I think that we need to be, you know, somewhat conservative when we talk about evidence from children and evidence from adults, because they could be reacting in quite different ways. Mm. You know.
Can we, I don't even know if you can make the assumption, or do we even know whether children are more empathetic than adults?
I find that a difficult question to answer.
There hasn't been any sort of study or research in that area.
It's hard to talk about whether, you know, how you would quantify the difference between the
two. I don't
know,
I guess I just think about children's imagination and that they haven't been colored by a ton of experience yet.
Yeah. Well, what I would say is that we can't make direct comparisons, because the way that children would express empathy would be different than the way that adults express empathy. So we don't have the exact same tools of measurement that we'd use for both that would allow for a direct comparison. Yeah. What I will say is that there's some pretty attractive evidence that very, very young children, even children that are nonverbal, you know, before they learn to speak or even walk, show a great deal of empathy and pro-social behavior towards others. So you might have heard of these studies where an adult would be in a room with a child and knock, you know, a set of books off of the table, right? And spontaneously, children will move towards the books and try and help them, you know, put the books on the table. And the key manipulation is that it only happens if the adult says, oops. But if they say, ha, like they did it intentionally, then they don't help. So they're actually helping under certain circumstances. And again, these are children that have not yet learned how to speak. Mm. So I think that's...
And what about, now this would be your area.
Yeah.
What about as far as fiction and empathy. What do we know about that?
Right. As far as fiction empathy goes, I think that we have pretty good evidence that among adults, the more fiction people have read, the higher they score on tasks related to empathy. You know, so that has been demonstrated across over a dozen studies. And there's recently been a meta-analysis, which is a way of aggregating the results over past studies. So it's aggregated all these different studies and found that the effect appears to be robust. So it's not just something that we find here in Toronto in my lab, but we find it in other parts of the world with other types of populations. So that seems to be rather robust.
Hmm. And does it matter what kind of fiction?
That's a really interesting question. So when we first started to look at this, we just looked at fiction very broadly speaking. And then from there, we started to move on to look at whether it was specific types of fiction that might be more impactful. And I would say that my first instincts were wrong. You know, so I used to go around giving talks saying that if there is, you know, I think that it would work for any fiction that provides an accurate representation of what the world is like, of what people's psychologies are like, what people are like. Any fiction that does that would work, was in mind. So I said, if there's one that wouldn't work, it would be romance novels, which I considered to have an inaccurate portrayal of human psychology. Now, it turns out I was wrong.
No.
Yeah. If you do the study, it turns out that exposure to romance novels was one of the most robust or strongest predictors of empathy when you look at lifetime exposure. And I think that that's really interesting. But we are, again, at these very early stages. You know, so some other people have done studies where they say it's not popular fiction, but it's only what they would refer to as literary or award-winning fiction. Things are a little bit mixed right now, so we're still trying to sort this out.
Okay. And do we know anything about nonfiction versus fiction?
Yes. So with respect to nonfiction versus fiction, that distinction has been relatively clear, that it's only fiction that has this benefit.
And finally, we need to move to visual arts. Mm-hmm. Now, my understanding, I think, from Professor Winner, was that there hasn't been a ton of research in this area.
Right, yeah, absolutely. And I would certainly agree. So I don't think we actually know. And that doesn't mean that it's not true or doesn't exist. It just means that we don't know. You know, there needs to be more work done in this area.
Is it an area that's more difficult to study? Like, why is it that we haven't really explored that? So I'm thinking of empathy. You're looking at an object. You're looking at a painting.
Yeah, it could be that it's more difficult. I think that these are certainly tractable problems. They're certainly empirical questions. It's open to empirical investigation. I think people haven't done it yet. I think that then in the past few years, there's been a real excitement about this topic in general, and I think that we're going to see a massive growth in research in this area moving forward. So I'm really hopeful that people will begin to take up this cause and do more studies on other types of arts like the visual arts, and I think it's just, we're right on the cusp of it.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, thank you. Thank you so much, Raymond Mar, for giving us the sort of the rundown and overview of the research in the area. So I'd like to open now the discussion up to the panel. Let me start first with you, Cameron. I don't know if you have any thoughts about what you heard, maybe specifically regarding the research on film, acting, theater.
All of it's fascinating to me. We spend a lot of time at TIFF thinking about how our audience is reacting to the films we're showing them. We've got a team of programmers who go out around the world trying to find the best films they can, but a film only works when it's engaging with an audience. So the audience has to respond, and the way that movies work typically is emotional. I think much more than literature and some other art forms, movies are an emotional medium. You're in the dark, you're surrendering to this big screen, you're kind of vulnerable in a way to the power of the film. And, you know, TIFF's mission is to try to transform the way people see the world through film. So we're already going after that. We're looking for a some tangible emotional reaction, which is typically about empathy. So we try to find films that will do that. I mean, a recent one, Slumdog Millionaire, I think is one of the best examples we've had recently, where it didn't have a lot of the usual markers of the movies we might show. There were no recognizable movie stars in the film. For many people who hadn't visited India, it was a new world to them. And yet, that was one of the most strong empathetic responses we've ever had to any film we've shown. Of course, it went on to incredible success, including an Academy Award.
Now, you brought a film clip, to show of Moonlight, which is currently running. Yeah. Can you introduce that and tell us why you brought this?
Sure, I'll just set this up a little bit. In terms of both, I'd say any, you know, fiction, film, theater, one of the things that I'm most interested in is how empathy is conditioned. So the more books you read, the more empathetic you get. But I also think that the more books you read and the more films you watch with certain kinds of characters, certain kinds of perspectives, certain kinds of stories, the more used you are to extending empathy to certain kinds of characters. And that's interesting in the context of Moonlight, because Moonlight is about black gay men in Florida. And these are characters who we have very rarely seen at the center of movies. We're much more conditioned to empathize with, you know, the angry young man, the middle-aged man going through a romantic crisis or a personal crisis, the action hero, all of these kinds of things, typically white in the case of Hollywood. And I think extending empathy to those kinds of characters is something we become incredibly conditioned to. Moonlight asks you to make a different, to take a different journey. And I was interested in that. The film has done incredibly well. I think we've seen it's been nominated for many, many Academy Awards this year. It won the Golden Globe for Best Drama. It's been playing at the TIFF Bell Light Box for weeks and weeks now, one of our most successful films in a long time. So I was interested in why that one worked and why we so rarely see that kind of movie and that invitation to empathy. This is, I think, the trailer from Moonlight.
Yeah, okay, let's play the trailer.
What you looking at me like that for? What, man? Come on, you just drove down here? Yeah.
Who is you, Sharon?
For a long time, try not to remember. Try to forget all those times.
At some point, you gotta decide for yourself who you gonna be. Can't let nobody make that decision for you.
You won't tell him why the other boys kick his ass all the time.
What's wrong?
I'm good.
No, I ain't seen good, and you ain't it.
Remember the last time I saw you?
Listen.
To who, Ma? Huh? To you? Who is you, man? I ain't seen you in like a decade. It's not what I expected. What did you expect?
Anybody here seen the film, Moonlight?
A few.
Quite a few.
I would encourage the rest of you to go see it, especially if you want to win your Oscar pool.
You said something interesting that I'd like Raymond to address. You were saying that, you know, the more you watch films, and for the most part, films have been a certain kind of film, right? We're not used to seeing blacks as the central characters, and it looked to me like an all-black cast.
Pretty much,
so we're not,
Mm-hmm.
So we're not used to seeing that. And so you were saying that when you see the same kind of films, and perhaps even their people of your own group, then you feel it easier and easier to extend that empathy to that group. Does that make sense to you? And I don't even know if the literature research bears that out.
Sure, yeah, it does. You know, by and large, what we're talking about here is identifying with a particular character.
Right.
And it's far easier to identify with characters that are similar to us for, you know, very pragmatic reasons that we can draw upon shared experiences and that sort of thing. So
right.
It can be more difficult, not impossible, more difficult for people to identify with characters that belong to groups that they don't get much contact with or that they don't belong to.
So then why is it that this film that is so different, mm-hmm. has become so popular,
mm-hmm.
and there are many, many people seeing it. You know, mm-hmm. as Cameron said, it's up for all these awards.
Mm-hmm.
How is it that something so different and unusual we seem to be empathizing with?
Mm-hmm.
Because that seems to go against what Cameron said earlier.
Right, again, it's not impossible, but it's more difficult. And here's my conjecture about why Moonlight works. I think it has to do with the time of disclosure regarding his sexual status and his sexual identity. You're quite a bit into the film and already care for the character.
Is this good for us to hear? Many of us haven't
really
seen it.
It's not actually a spoiler.
Okay.
Yeah,
no, it's fine.
Yeah. I think it was already mentioned that the character is a young black gay male. Right. And also low socioeconomic status.
Yeah, and just so people know, you see him at three stages of his life, childhood, adolescence, and then as a grown man.
Right, yeah. And so my hunch, just conjecture, is that you can identify much easier with him when the film begins, because at that point, other parts of his more complex identity haven't yet been revealed. And so you're sympathetic to the part that he's a child. We're naturally more sympathetic to children, and he begins in the film as a child, and he certainly is suffering, and it definitely generates empathy. Mm. And I think that the more complicated disclosures that arrive later, by then you're already in. Mm. Also, it's also true that the performances are fantastic, and the filmmaking is just amazing. Like, performances at all three stages of the film are stunning.
I don't know, Martha, if you have anything to add, whether you're a film buff. When you go see films, you look for characters that you personally you can relate to, or do you look for sort of a broad, a breadth of different types of characters on screen?
Well, I think it depends on the medium, right? You're looking for people that you can relate to in film or in theater, even in music, you listen to sound that you can relate to. But when you see things that are impactful, that tell a story in a very compelling way, I think that it can create empathy, or you can empathize with their position. So I myself, I look for a wide variety of things.
Yeah. See, and I agree. When you said impactful and portrayals of characters where initially we may not think we're going to like this person. We may not think we're going to empathize with person, and then we do end up. So, is that really kind of the great acting ability of someone who's able to overcome perhaps our initial hesitation to be empathetic or to respond? Cameron, I don't know.
I think what great drama tries to do is to find the common humanity in their protagonist. So whether somebody is a complete monster in their actions, if you can find some point of connection, these actors are trained to do this. This is what they're taught to do. They're taught to play not the villainy, but the humanity in the villain. And I think Meryl Streep has been terrific at that. Devil Wears Prada is probably a good example.
Sophie's Choice, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
Another good example.
Mm-hmm. Martha, I want to bring you into the conversation here. Mm-hmm. It was interesting because when I was doing a lot of reading about empathy, museums kept popping up. And I did not realize that empathy and museums, it's been a hot topic for a while. I think a lot of people know about an event that happened at the ROM not that long ago, and I think there's an empathy connection to this, and it was the African exhibit that the ROM addressed. Can you talk about that?
Sure. So in 1989, a long time ago, 27 years ago, there was an exhibit at the ROM called Out of Africa, and it was an attempt by the curators to portray how the ethics of museum collecting during colonial times. And it portrayed colonials in Africa and totally missed the mark. It managed to offend just about everybody who was involved. It had, and it really was portrayed from a very colonial point of view. And it was deemed to be racist by a lot of the African community at the time. There were a lot of violence outside of the museum. There were people that were arrested. There was one person that spent 6 months in jail. There was the exhibit was built to travel across North America, and everyone else backed off. Nobody else would take the exhibit, so it wasn't particularly successful. Obviously, because it had a huge impact on the African-Canadian community. That community stayed out to a certain degree. Those individuals stayed out of the museum for all those years. It really did have a huge impact on the relationship of the ROM with the African-Canadian community.
But those protests kept going on, right?
The protests went on for quite a long time, and the museum was toned deaf to it at the time. They believed that their efforts to present it in a certain way were correct, and they didn't acknowledge that it was interpreted in a different way. 27 years later, and after a number of attempts, the ROM decided to apologize to this coalition of people who really had kept up the discussion for all these years. And they worked on it for over 2 years on the language and on what they would do. It was not just the language of the apology, but also all of the outreach and the activities that went along with it that the ROM is committed to do over the years. And I had the good fortune of attending this event, and it was very, very emotional. The people that were involved, obviously this exhibit had a huge impact on them for years, for their lives, and they had stayed together as a group. One of them came from Nigeria, another one came from Jamaica, another from New York. They came from, their lives had moved on, but this brought them all together again. And it was just an amazing, it's hard to describe, it was amazing to be there because it was so, they were so appreciative that the ROM would finally, after all these years, acknowledge that the exhibit was in fact racist. Mm-hmm. And the other thing it did is at the time the ROM since then, and museums since then, have learned that you need to, in order to present objects or present an exhibit that reflects a community, you need to have the community's point of view. And you need to have the outreach to the community and make sure that you're not just creating something through the eyes of a historian or a curator or through the objects, but you're looking at it from the eyes of the audience, as you said. The audience needs to be appreciative and to be reflected in that exhibit. So those kinds of strategies for working with communities are pretty standard now. I guess at the time they weren't.
Oh, okay. So were these things then already, had the ROM evolved to that point where they were already getting community input, already collaborating with different, you know, groups and parties, or did that actually make another change within the ROM?
I think that made a change. Part of the issue was they didn't have the community involved with the exhibit. Mm. Now, of course, it's what you do.
I think it speaks to point of view. I think that's really the key part here. I remember 1989 very well.
Do you?
Yeah, definitely. I was certainly a part of those protests. And I think what's really key here is not just, when we talk about empathy in the arts, not just empathizing with the subjects in a work of art, the characters in a story or that kind of thing, but the point of view that Right. the work of art is presenting, whether it's a curated museum show or a novel or a movie. So, you know, the ROM show, I think, had, good intentions, clearly, but hadn't, I don't think, fully considered the point of view of
all.
The people who were being represented. And just the intense pain that people who have been, who've grown up in colonized cultures feel to see the objects from their own cultures taken out of their context and exhibited in a museum in a curatorial frame that they've had no part in
Right.
whatsoever. And that, I think, is that sense of point of view and wanting to be involved in it is, I think, really key. You can compare, for instance, in the film context, a film like Django Unchained, which is also largely about African-American characters, about slavery, has, again, good intentions in terms of flipping the script and making the enslaved African the hero. A lot of black people don't like that movie at all. Because of the point of view yeah. in it, right? And I think it's very different from a film like Moonlight, which allows a full range of humanity for its African-American characters in a way that Tarantino, I think, hasn't quite wrapped his head around yet. Mm-hmm. So that difference of perspective and point of view, I think, is really key when it comes to empathy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Martha, you brought some
I did.
Yeah, pictures as well that you wanted to talk about. Yeah, why don't you call them up?
So I have three slides. This is just give you an idea. It's from the Pompeii exhibit. So it's just a view of the objects. They laid it out showing life in Pompeii, a lot of beautiful objects, kind of a standard way of presenting objects taken from that time. We move on, you go through the exhibit, and then you come to very near the end where they start showing the excavations of the bodies and how they discovered the what were white spaces, and they filled them with plaster, and what they found, there were shapes of bodies. And there's one more, I think there's a picture of a dog. Yeah, this the final one. And so through, I mean, you ask whether objects can, or exhibits can actually evoke empathy. And you, in this kind of exhibit, it's a story. You work through the story, you understand their daily life, you can put yourself in their shoes, and then you can put yourself in their shoes of the violence and the violent deaths that they met with after the volcano overtook the city. So it's just an example of, I think, a way an exhibit and a museum can present a story and evoke empathy in the audience. It's a different way.
Yeah, do you know, what's I found really interesting is when I was looking up some of the research on empathy and how the word came about, and it comes from a German word over a century ago, apparently the original definition involved your relationship with an object. Mm-hmm. It wasn't with another person. It was with, there was something, an exchange going on between you and an object. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting. I have one other example, and this is, it's just really a simple object, but it tells the story. It's from A Course in Aboriginal Schools. There's an exhibit on at the ROM right now about life in the schools, and it's very, I think it's very impactful. It's very plain. It's just sitting out in the middle of the room and tells a big story about how young children lived, were taken away from their families and sent to the schools.
One of the things I wanted to bring up with museums as well is when I was reading this one article that was talking about putting empathy into museums. So making that a fundamental part of how museums are designed, how they curate exhibitions. And I don't know whether this is a topic at the ROM, whether you discuss an empathic museum. I have no idea whether that's come up or not.
So, I mean, I'm on the board, so I'm not in the ROM, but I would say that you can institutionalize empathy in the sense that you do it by creating diversity, you do it by ensuring that all points of view are represented, and you can force that. You can force that on a board by making sure it's diverse, by its volunteers, by its curators, making sure that they represent their community. You can institutionalize ways of reaching out to the community to make sure that you're getting those points of view through outreach activities. So there are things I think that institutions can do to make sure that they are empathetic in a way.
But doesn't it get a little tricky and challenging? I mean, the African exhibition is I think a pretty clear cut. We understand what was going on there.
Right.
If you have another kind of exhibition that is controversial and the two sides are opposing sides, and it's not quite clear, right? Who's the good guy? Who's the bad guy in this? There are two definite opposing points of view. And you know what I mean? So if you're taking an empathy point of view, how does the museum then, you know, depict that? Or how do you, so what I'm getting at is when you institutionalize empathy, I think that's quite a different thing than an individual, you know, empathizing and showing empathy for something, because an institution, now you have so many different points of view. Can you ever be fair to that concept of empathy? Do you know what I'm getting at, Cameron? I find it a bit of a challenge.
I do think it's tricky. I think you're right. Institutions do have points of view, and they evolve over time, and they can shift, and they can be a little bit more multiple, a little bit broader than an individual's. But I think we can look at any arts institution and say, yes, they have a perspective. And that's changing. That changes over time. The ROM now is different than the ROM 50 years ago. Mm-hmm. TIFF now is different than TIFF was 30 or 40 years ago. Mm-hmm. I think as much as possible, you have to try to draw from what your constituency wants and the range of sort of empathetic relationships they have, rather than try to impose them. But it has to be a kind of a dialogue, I would hope.
But then again, your constituency may be only made up of certain kinds of people, and you would like to broaden that.
That's a tough thing. We have something at TIFF called the Film Circuit, where we're based in Toronto, right in downtown Toronto, King and John. The Film Circuit goes across to 185 communities across Canada, small communities. So it could be Perth, Ontario. It could be Salmon Arm in BC. We're showing movies there as well. The context shifts a lot. We then have to listen to them, because what's going to work in downtown Toronto is not necessarily the same in terms of the films, how we present them, how we have discussions afterwards. And so our understanding of those communities is really essential, rather than trying to impose our own sort of perspective or point of view on a small Canadian town.
Raymond, I want to ask you, I mean, the example of the African exhibition is an interesting one, because over time, it seems like the ROM, they were listening. They were finally listening. They were empathetic to what they heard from the voices around them, and then they addressed it. I'm interested in knowing whether the research shows when the arts, when something is able to create empathy in a person, do we know whether that then causes a change in behavior the way the ROM had done recently, right? So it's one thing, you know, I read a book, it's about a homeless person, let's say, and I feel empathetic towards this person. I feel the person's pain. Does that necessarily mean, or does the evidence exist that I now will feel differently about the homeless people in Toronto? And then will I even act on it? Do we have any research on that?
There is some research on this, but again, it's the thing that's very difficult to study, you know, because we're talking about things that probably occur over long spans of time. It's not the case that, you know, you read one book, you watch one movie, and you're just completely flip over. I mean, part of what we're often talking about our interactions with the arts, how they might affect our empathy, we're talking about frequent exposure to the arts, you know, exposure to lots of different viewpoints, a huge diversity of viewpoints, not just one single instance. It's not a magic bullet that will transform people. So there have been studies that did look at behavior and that did show some links to helping behavior and more pro-social sort of activities. So there is some evidence like that, but it's limited. You know, it's a thing it's very difficult to study, and science itself is limited. You know, so.
And the thing is, too, I wonder, because when you start with your participants, right, how do you know what level of empathy they're at?
Well, that can be measured. Yeah, so you can actually measure their baseline level of empathy and then see whether that empathy changes over time. And so there was a study that was done in Italy, for example, where they did just this. They measured baseline levels of empathy, and they had people read an entire book from one of three different genres, and then tried to see whether there was any changes in that empathy level. And they did observe changes, but for those who read literary fiction.
Can we ever have too much empathy?
I'm not sure. I mean, I think that, as with anything, there's too much of a good thing. You know, I grew up with a friend whose aunt got hospitalized for eating too many carrots, you know. she turned bright orange. This is a true story. So there is, no matter what you're talking about, there's too much of a thing. People can exercise themselves to death. Would this be an argument against exercise or against carrots? Probably not. You know, so even if there is a possibility that we could become too overwhelmed with emotion, that we become paralyzed and can't act, that this doesn't happen very frequently, and it certainly wouldn't be a good argument against empathy.
Well, I mean, we have heard of cases where, I mean, people read, let's say, Harry Potter. Mm-hmm. They are totally, enraptured by that world, mm-hmm. and they become so addicted mm-hmm. to something like that, where they start losing touch with the real world, or they can't function as well as mm-hmm. they used to.
Yep.
I mean, and not just fiction, but there are other examples that exist.
Yeah, we're talking about millions and millions of people reading the Harry Potter books, and you just need one, and it becomes a very attractive story. Does this mean that every Harry Potter reader becomes so divorced from reality that it affects them adversely? No. In fact, is it many Harry Potter readers that lose touch with reality? Probably not. You know?
Can I ask a question about identification versus empathy?
Sure.
Is that a distinction
Absolutely.
That we can make? Because in fiction and movies and theater, of course, it's one thing to identify with the protagonist.
Yep.
But what does it mean to move from that to empathy?
Yeah, I think they're closely related, and these words are often used interchangeably, and it can be very difficult to sort of cut them as to when they are totally distinct. Mm-hmm. But I think when it comes to character identification, it's often about taking on the role of that character to a point where you lose much access to your own sort of feelings and emotions.
Mm-hmm. Look, can I just follow that up then quickly? Sorry, Mary, to ask another question.
No, please, go ahead.
There's been some talk in, say, film critic circles in the wake of what's happened south of the border with the election that the rise of superhero movies, the Marvel and the DC comic book movies, where you've got a kind of a nihilistic worldview and a superhuman figure comes out of that nihilism and chaos and is able to save the world every single time after dealing with massive carnage and creating massive carnage. But that actually has sort of desensitized audiences, especially in the US, to the kind of the more small-scale, mundane qualities of life, and that they're actually, they see life in this sort of massive, sort of triumphal aspect, and that it is good and evil, good guys and bad guys, there's carnage to be had, and you need a kind of a wisecracking, smart-ass, superhuman character to come along and save things, and it doesn't matter what the collateral damage is, as long as they fix the world. And that's what happened on November 8th.
I knew somehow that was going to come up today.
So I guess the question is, are we identifying? Are we empathizing? What's happening?
So I think it's an interesting possibility, and it's a good discussion to have. Mm-hmm. I think that my own take on those movies is they've been relatively nuanced and good at including lots of human elements. So there's a lot of themes about loyalty and close relationships, and there actually has been some discussion in those films about the collateral damage, the massive destruction that was done towards New York and Gotham, and people then turning to the other side, So I think that that actually does appear within the films. So I would be hesitant to paint things with such broad strokes.
Sure,
I know
that
Marvel and other comic book companies have been working hard, actually, to include a greater diversity of perspectives within their comic books. More representation of minorities, of women, sexual minorities even. I mean, all those things have been appearing with greater and greater frequency.
In the comic books before the movies, though.
Right.
Good point. Yeah,
right. Yeah. Yeah. So since you bring that up, let me ask, because I started off with this in my introduction, do you feel that we do have a deficit of empathy today, that there is a lack of empathy? Martha, do you think there is?
I think, well, just picking up on Cameron's point, I mean, if you're able to put yourself in the shoes of a character or in a book or in a movie, and they're increasingly violent, they're increasingly not very real, the superheroes, I think that it does create a lack of empathy. And I think what we see in the US is a lack of empathy for the lives of people that they live with, for immigrants who have been in the country for a generation or so, for people who come to America. I mean, there seems to be a lack of empathy. And it could be film, it could be television, reality TV. It could be all sorts of things that are influencing that. Mm. Or a deficit of the arts. I mean, look what's happening. The endowment of the arts is going to be shut down if we listen to what's going on in south of the border.
Cameron, what do you think?
What I see, and this is only my own perspective, but what I see is that we're living in an increasingly complex, diverse societies now, certainly in most of the West, lots of different people from all over, different histories. There's less and less that we share in terms of how we all grew up. And I think it's in that context, it's easier for people to kind of retreat into smaller and smaller worlds where they're in a kind of an empathy echo chamber, right? So your Facebook only shows you people who pretty much agree with you. Right. Most of your social media is the same way. Often because we don't watch the same TV shows anymore, right? Everyone used to sit down on a Wednesday night and watch the exact same TV show. That doesn't happen anymore. We're all streaming hundreds and hundreds of different things that reflect our own perspectives, our own worldviews. And I think those smaller and smaller circles in the wake of increasing chaos outside is a real threat to empathy.
Mm.
Yeah, I would agree entirely. My own sort of take on things is that there's been a greater sharing of experiences, and part of it has led to an ironic backlash where we're rejecting those experiences. So on Twitter, for example, we're hearing people talk more and more that, they feel like you know, they've had these difficulties that they're being profiled if they're a minority, they're being profiled by the police, or women complaining about street harassment. And the reaction to that has been, you know, not positive. You know, people tend to think, I don't have this experience, and what you're
and
telling me.
I don't want
me,
to hear about it.
That's right. Yeah. Either right. It's not true. Yeah. I don't want to hear about it. Yeah. Or your take on it is wrong. You know, and the feeling is just that other people saying that they experience the world quite vastly different than we might experience it leads people to say you're invalidating my experience. And so no, my experience of the world is correct, and your experience of the world is incorrect because we can't seem to reconcile the fact that we could live in the same city, walk the same streets, go to the same stores, and yet have vastly different experiences because of who we are.
So if I were just to bring up this whole, like, the Trump analogy into this, and the idea that we are moving into these sort of silos or small groups, could you not argue, though, that, you know, yes, we may feel that, you know, Trump's take on immigration, on women, all that, that's not good, right? We disagree. But then where is our empathy for those people who support that?
And I think that's a very important point. So we should be able to recognize a shared humanity about what are the impulses driving these ideologies that we find so distasteful, right? Because there is something there. There has to be something there. We're all human. We all have a shared you know, biology and architecture and environment. And we should be able to understand what motivates people to behave in ways that seem so foreign to us, because they're frankly not monsters, they're humans, the way that we are.
It seems to me, though, that we can empathize with what is causing that kind of reaction in the U.S. It's a country with 12 million illegal immigrants, undocumented immigrants. They have huge problems, but it doesn't mean that you have to agree with the solution.
No.
I think no one's saying that.
Right? Yeah. But I'm saying that the better that you understand the impulses, the better you're able to then present your side as to why you think this might not be the best solution. Right. Mm-hmm. And a failure of understanding will also lead to a failure to change the world and convince other people. And if you believe,
I'm just going to ask on that point, where does empathy run up against morality or ethics? So, you know, it's very easy. You mentioned the residential schools, and, you know, incredible abuses took place in those schools.
Right.
We can empathize with the children who were the victims, but are we also empathizing with the teachers and the priests who were running those schools and abusing children?
You should be able to recognize them as, you know, human, because humans are not all good, you know? Like, we can recognize bad impulses with the humans and recognize it as still a human impulse. That doesn't mean that we condone it, right? But I think it's important to understand it if we are to prevent it, right? That's why understanding is important.
So let me just end off, because we're running out of time. So if we all kind of acknowledge that there is a gap in empathy or a deficit in empathy, I think that's probably always existed in some way or another, a deficit in empathy, and we can always do better. How do we do better through the arts? You know, can we intentionally use the arts in such a way to create empathy, to foster empathy?
I mean, coming back to roots of empathy, I think that the arts, it can help children with empathy for sure. Children are more open to taking on roles and understanding different points of view. So using the arts in that way and will definitely have an impact. I think, I mean, the power of film and the power of good television and a good novel for sure can have an impact, and I think the arts can be present an alternative point of view. I mean, the arts are really alternative reality. It's just creating a reality that's different from yours, so that you can feel what others feel. So I agree that we definitely can.
What, Cameron?
Yeah, I think to me it's a kind of a muscle, and I think the more you exercise it, the better at it you get, the stronger it gets. So it's not just a matter of reading more books or watching more films or looking at more art, but it's a matter, I think, of kind of contending with the art that you engage with. Mm-hmm. So you're stretching yourself through doing that. You're testing your muscles. You're working your muscles by watching films that maybe are a little bit beyond your range of understanding, reading books that are about worlds that you'll never experience yourself. But you push yourself that way, and I think that empathy muscle gets stronger.
That's interesting, because, you know, I was thinking, you know how they say with to sort of stave off dementia. Yeah, that you should not be doing the same kinds of things, right? You need to reroute and rewire your brain differently. So don't do that same dance. Learn a different kind of dance.
Right.
So it's almost kind of like what you're saying, right?
Yeah,
to use your
idea.
Muscles in a different way and maybe maybe see that film that you wouldn't have seen, but it's going to challenge you and make
that's
you think in a different way.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think a lot of art challenges us in that way, and I think that all the arts have a role here. I think that there's something very different and immediate about, you know, going to a museum and seeing an actual physical object, you know, related to a time that is very difficult in our history, rather than just hearing about it abstractly. It's something that brings it immediately to home, and you presented that picture of a desk, and it is only a wooden desk with an inkwell.
Right.
But it reminds us all that this was real, that this happened, and that someone that size was horribly abused.
All right. I think we're going to close because we've just about ran out of time. So my thanks to our panel tonight, Cameron Bailey from TIFF. We've got Martha Durdin from ROM and also Professor Raymond Mar from York University. And my apologies to Alan Winner, who wasn't able to be with us tonight. Thank you.